Wonderful hymn. Jesus paid it all. The Lord Jesus Christ was in the Garden of Gethsemane when soldiers sent by the religious political authority of the day for the Jewish nation, the Sanhedrin, guided one of his 12 disciples by the name of Judas Iscariot to the Garden of Gethsemane with the purpose of arresting him. And it was there that Judas betrayed Jesus. And you know how he did it? He did it how? With a kiss. That's correct. And in so doing, he betrayed the Lord Jesus Christ, and he was subsequently arrested. Well, we have an interesting story that takes place that I want to focus in at that point in time. In John chapter 18, it talks about how that one of the other of the 12 disciples, Simon Peter, and it goes on to say this. It said, who had a sword, drew it, and struck the high priest's servant, cutting off his right ear. The servant's name was Malchus. Now, I think in this context that Peter really wasn't aiming at cutting off Malchus's ear. He was intending to kill him. That's correct. As a matter of fact, I think the issue was that because Peter was not a soldier but a fisherman, his aim was a little bit off. But it accomplished a significant event in the loss of that man's ear. Well, the response of Jesus to that is he turns to Peter and says to him, put your sword back in its place, for all who draw the sword will die by the sword. Once you choose the route of violence, you commit yourself to being responded to with violence as well. Bad choice. And Jesus, of course, stood against forms of violence. And then he did a most amazing thing. The scripture says that Jesus healed the man's ear. And Jesus answered, no more of this. And he touched the man's ear and healed him. Now, I think this is kind of ironic, if you want my opinion. Here's the man who's coming to arrest Jesus and who wants to bring him back to trial and ultimately his death. And he gets his ear hacked off and Jesus heals him. Now, this is most counterintuitive, I would suggest. And then he and the others just keep on with the arrest process and keep on going to the authorities. To me, what I see in this is that if I had been amongst the Jewish religious leadership, the Pharisees and the other members of the Sanhedrin who were coordinating this arrest, I would have been doing some double thinking. I would have been thinking to myself, wait a minute, if this guy can heal a chopped off ear, maybe we shouldn't be arresting him as a common criminal. I would think that's the way you should respond in that context. But as you know, the story carries on, the arrest carries on, even though this amazing thing has just happened. And it is at this point when Peter hacks off the ear of Malchus, the high priest's servant, and Jesus asks Peter the question that is the text for my message. Do you think I cannot call on my Father, and he will at once put at my disposal more than 12 legions of angels? 12 legions of angels. We'll look at that in a moment, exactly what the number is there. Now, back when I was growing up, I started reading. I think I read the Bible. I read the Bible through from cover to cover the first time when I was 9 years of age. And I remember reading through the Gospels, and when I would get to this part of Jesus's arrest, trial, crucifixion, death, and such, I remember there would be such an anger developing within me, the sense of injustice, how that Jesus was going through this, and it seemed, as in my little childhood mind, 9 years of age, how unfair that was. And I remember thinking, I would love to have been there, and I would love to have just taken that knife and jammed it in the gut of those guys who were. I wouldn't just have chopped off his head. I would have plunged it into his stomach and got him. I wanted to have been there and to defend Jesus. I wanted to fight off the arresting soldiers, lop off a few ears, maybe even a lot more than that I would have done. And then I wanted to go to his trial and stand up and yell to Pontius Pilate, "Foul! This is a travesty of justice," and intervene. And then when he was being nailed to the cross, I would have gone and grabbed the hammer from that man who's nailing Jesus to the cross. And I would have said, "Give it to me." But really, when you look at it, Jesus didn't need the help of a 9, 10, or 11-year-old boy to get off the cross, because he said he could have called for and God would have sent him 10,000 angels to set him free. Let's look at that. What does that mean? What's the implications for us today, this Good Friday? Let's pray. Father in heaven, as we look at what the Word of God says and the teaching concerning Jesus' death on our behalf, and specifically his statement that he could have called for 10,000 angels to come and set him free, but he didn't, and the reason why. And as we go through this, we want to do it with an attitude of gratitude. Lord Jesus, thank you for all you suffered for us. None of us, myself included, are worthy of the suffering, the shame, the beating, the spitting, being spat upon, the whipping, the humiliation, the carrying of the cross, the being nailed to the cross and hanging on the cross there in open view, and then finally dying. Lord, none of us are worthy of that. We recognize we are all sinners that have fallen short of the glory of God and don't deserve this, but you in your grace and mercy did it for us, and we want to say thank you. And this morning we celebrate this incredible event. And I stand against all the forces of darkness and command every evil spirit in the strong name of Jesus to go. Holy Spirit, I welcome you here. Guide and lead us into the truth for your honor and glory. In Christ's name we pray. And everybody said? Now, when in defense of his arrest there in the Garden of Gethsemane, and Peter had lopped off one of the ears of the soldiers who had come to arrest him, Jesus had, in my opinion, and what he actually said, a very good option, what Jesus could have done. And he said that that option was to be able to call for a very large number of angels to come and deliver him. And the statement he makes in our text, he says, "Do you think I cannot call on my Father, and he will at once put at my disposal more than 12 legion angels?" Now, you notice this question is asked expecting the affirmative answer. Yes, he could do that. Now, 12 legion angels. In the Roman army, a legion was 6,000 soldiers. So if you do the math, you multiply that by 12, that's 72,000 soldiers. Can you imagine what 72,000 soldiers could have done to those 10, 12, 15 arresting soldiers who had come to get him there in the Garden of Gethsemane? Can you imagine them coming in? 72,000 soldiers descending upon that motley group. Now, back in the Old Testament, we have the story of in 2 Samuel chapter 14, where one angel alone ends up destroying 70,000 people during the time of David. 2 Samuel says, it puts it this way in chapter 24, verse 15 and 16. "So the Lord sent a plague on Israel from that morning until the end of time designated, and 70,000 of the people from Dan to Beersheba." Dan is in the north of Israel. Beersheba is in the very south. The whole country saw 70,000 people die. One angel. And then you read in the book of Revelation, seven angels are the ones who pour out the seven last plagues on the world. And John the Revelator writes in Revelation 16:1, "And then I heard a loud voice from the temple saying to the seven angels, go pour out the seven bowls of God's wrath on the earth." And you know the devastation that will come. This is doing what the Bible calls the tribulation period, and it's in the future. We don't know when. It could be immediately following the rapture. It will be immediately following the rapture, and we don't know when that'll happen. It could be any moment. And when these events take place, the action of God in judgment upon the world will be incredible. And there you have seven angels do this. Think what 72,000 angels could do. Now, that would have meant that Jesus would have been set free from the awful experience of death on the cross. Years ago, a song was written. They took the more common number of 10,000. They actually lowered it by 62,000. And it was entitled, "He Could Have Called 10,000 Angels." I have a video clip of the song being sung. Hopefully our technology worked. Guys, let's run that song. Candidly, Jesus did struggle with going to the cross. In the Garden of Gethsemane, when he went to pray to his Father, he made the request. He said, "Father, if it is possible, may this cup taken from me." And this cup symbolized the suffering he was going to go through, and drinking it symbolized acceptance of what God wanted him to go through. John chapter 12, verse 27, another prayer, he says, "Now my heart is troubled, and what shall I say? Father, save me from this hour." It was a very, very real battle for him. We won't deny it. Surrendering to the will of God can be tough in our lives. Maybe you are this morning struggling with that same battle in your life. You know God is calling on you, asking you to respond, to give your life to him fully. And you are pushing away. You're saying, perhaps you've never accepted Jesus Christ as Savior, and you're saying, "No, I'm not going to do it, not going to do it, not going to do it." Maybe you're going to have other issues in your lives. Your unwillingness to forgive someone who's offended you. Your unwillingness to deal with an ongoing sin in your life and getting rid of that. Maybe the fact that you don't read your Bible every day. Just a number of things where you push away. push away, push away. And maybe God is working in your life in the same way as he did in Jesus's. Now, I suggest to you, here's my counsel to you. Don't resist him as did the people that Stephen, the first Christian martyr in the New Testament, describes in his conversation, in his sermon to the Jews in Acts chapter 7, verse 51. He says to them, "You stiff-necked people with uncircumcised hearts and ears, you are just like your fathers." Notice the last phrase he says, "You always resist the Holy Spirit." And so my counsel to you is don't do that. Don't resist. It's an unwise move on your part. Not smart. Now, we all know what Jesus ended up choosing to do. He died on the cross. So why, instead of calling 72,000 angels to sweep down from heaven and to scoop him up and out of that dangerous situation he was in, why did he forego that option, excuse me, and choose rather to submit to the humiliating death on the cross? Excuse me. The answer is found in a conversation that he has with his Heavenly Father in his prayer in the Garden of Gethsemane, when he prayed and he said, "My Father, if it is possible for this cup to be taken, if it is not possible for this cup to be taken away unless I drink it," notice, and I've italicized the next part of that, "may your will be done." He surrendered to the will of God in his life. And there's two reasons why. And the first reason why I want to suggest to you is because that was the original reason for his coming into the world in the first place. In the eternal plan of God, it was decided Jesus would leave heaven's glory and come to earth to die for humankind's sin. And so that was the plan that God had right from day one. Galatians chapter 4, verse 4 says, "But when the time had fully come, God sent his Son, born of a woman, born under the law, to redeem those under the law, that we might receive full rights as sons." 1 Timothy 1:15, "Here is a trustworthy saying that deserves full acceptance. Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners." And then Paul makes this editorial comment about himself, "Of whom I am the worst." Hebrews 10:5, it says, "But when Christ came into the world, he said, 'Sacrifice and offering you did not desire, but a body you prepared for me.'" And so that's why when Jesus was wrestling in the garden as to whether he should do it or not, he knew that's the reason he had come for it. And that's why he says in John 12:27, "Now my heart is troubled. And what shall I say? Father, save me from this hour." It's, and essentially he's saying no. Goes on to say, "It was for this very reason I came to this hour." And Hebrews 10:7, it says, as he was dying, he says, "Here I am. It is written about me in the scroll. I have come to do your will, O God." Jesus kept his promise to God to do what God wanted him to do. Ecclesiastes 5:4 says, "And when you make a vow to God, do not delay in fulfilling it. He has no pleasure in fools. Fulfill your vow." If you make a promise to God, keep it. And that's what Jesus was doing. He was promising, had promised God he would do that, and he was fulfilling it. And he chose not the option of dying on the cross, calling the angels, I should say. He chose the option of dying on the cross. Secondly, Jesus chose to die on the cross instead of being delivered by 72,000 angels because, really, he said there was no other way for the prophecies to be fulfilled. And when he made this comment to Peter, he said, Do you think I cannot call on my Father and he will at once put at my disposal more than 12 legions of angels? And then notice the next statement. He says, "But then how would the scriptures be fulfilled that say it must happen this way?" In other words, for hundreds of years already, it had been written down in the part of the Bible we call the Old Testament, what the Messiah, Jesus, the Son of God, was going to die. And the result is those prophecies had foretold he had to die, and so Jesus was compelled to fulfill the prophecy. In Luke chapter 24, when he meets with the two disciples on the road to Emmaus following his resurrection, and he's describing the events, they're describing the events of this day, and they're confused as to what's happened to this Jesus who was supposed to be the Messiah, now he's dead, and he says to them, "How foolish you are and how slow of heart to believe all the prophets have spoken. Did not the Christ, i.e. the Messiah, have to suffer these things and then enter into his glory?" And then it goes on to say, at the end of that passage, it says, "And beginning with Moses and the prophets," what he means by that is the Old Testament. Beginning at the Old Testament, He explained to them what was said in the scriptures concerning himself. And so scripture after scripture in the Old Testament predicted the death of Christ. For example, Psalm 22 is a classic illustration of this. In the whole chapter there, statement after statement. Now, you got to remember, Psalm 22, written by King David, psalmist of Israel, was written 1,000 years before Jesus. So 1,000 years in advance, this is what David writes. My God, why have you forsaken me? Why are you so far from saving me, so far from the words of my groaning? And we read in Matthew 27, verse 46, about the ninth hour, that's 3 o'clock in the afternoon, Jesus cried out with a loud voice, Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani, that's Aramaic. And in translation, it says, my God, why have you forsaken me? Exactly what David had predicted 1,000 years before. Psalms 22, David had made the description this way, I am poured out like water. All my bones are out of joint. Do you know when crucified, when people are crucified, guys were crucified, the thing that happened is that their shoulder sockets pulled out of joint by hanging all the weight over a period of time, and the bones went out of joint. Goes on to say, my heart is turned to wax. It is melted away within me. My strength is dried up like a potsherd. My tongue sticks to the roof of my mouth. You lay me in the dust of death. And then you read in the New Testament, John 19, later, knowing that all was now completed and that the scripture would be fulfilled, Jesus said, I am thirsty. And a jar of vinegar, wine vinegar, was there, and they soaked a sponge in it, put the sponge on the stalk of a hyssop plant, and lifted it to Jesus' lips. How precisely is that fulfilled? And in Psalm 22, the psalmist puts it this way, a band of evil men has encircled me. They have pierced my hands and feet. How did Jesus get on the cross? They nailed his hands and feet to the cross. He says in Psalm 22, I can count all my bones. People stare and gloat over me. And we see this in Mark 15. Those who passed by hurled insults at him, shaking their heads and saying, so you who are going to destroy the temple and build it 3 days, come down from the cross and save yourself. And in the same way, the chief priests and the teachers of the law mocked him among themselves. He saved others, but he couldn't save himself. And then they went on to say, let this Christ, the King of Israel, come down now from the cross that we may see and believe. And then Jesus, in Psalm 22, the psalmist says, they divide my garments among them and cast lots for my clothing. Remember, 1,000 years before, and you have a series. This is not only one by chance statement. Statement after statement after statement after statement. And notice how the fulfillment happens in the New Testament. When the soldiers crucified Jesus, they took his clothes, dividing them into 4 shares, one for each of them, with the undergarment remaining. The garment was seamless, woven in one piece from top to bottom. Let's not tear it, they said to one another. Let's decide by lot who will get it. And then John, writing about this, says, this happened that the scripture might be fulfilled, which said, they divided my garments among them and cast lots for my clothing. So this is what the soldiers did. And then probably the most significant fact of the death of Christ was this. It was completely voluntary on his part. Jesus laid down his life of his own free will. And he said in John 10, the reason my Father loves me is that I lay down my life only to take it up again, referring to the resurrection. No one takes it from me. In other words, he wasn't killed. He surrendered to death. Just as I lay down of my own accord, I have authority to, just as I lay down my own accord, I have authority to lay it down and authority to take it up again. This command I received from my Father. And I want you to notice when he was dying on the cross, the description of his final moment says, and when he had received the wine, Jesus said, it is finished. And with that, he bowed his head and gave up his spirit. You don't give up your spirit when you die. It's taken from you. He voluntarily gave it up. And Luke puts it this way, and Jesus cried out with a loud voice, Father, into your hands I commit my spirit. And when he said this, he breathed his last. It's interesting, when Joseph of Arimathea went to Pontius Pilate to get permission to bury the body of Jesus, we read, it says that Pilate was surprised to hear he had already was already dead. Summoning the centurion, he asked him if he had already died, and he found out that that indeed was the case, and it was surprising to Pontius Pilate that he was dead already. Now, you realize Jesus died at 3 in the afternoon, And he had to be buried before sunset. Sunset in Israel at this time of year, well, most of the year, is around 6 in the evening. And when Joseph of Arimathea went to Pilate, maybe about 4 o'clock in the afternoon, he's got a couple of hours to get this done before sunset in the beginning of Sabbath. And he hears he's dead already. That was surprising because the crucified man lived up to 2 weeks on the cross. Well, Jesus chose to die for you, and you, and you, and you, and you, and me. Essentially, he was saying, I'm doing this for you, for you. If you were the only one who ever lived on planet Earth, he would have done it for you. He could have called 72,000 angels, but he died alone for you and me. A pastor was visiting a farmer, and they went out to the chicken coop where the farmer had his chickens, kind of like Horia Sarb with all his animals on his farm. I hear he's now even got a cow. You don't have any chickens. That's next. Pastor went to visit the farmer, and they went to the chicken coop, and there on one of the nests sat a hen. But when the farmer touched the hen, he discovered that she was cold and dead. However, peeking out from under the wings was a brood of little ones. And the farmer said to the pastor, look at the wound on her head. A weasel must have come into the chicken coop and attacked her. And he went on to say, he sucked all the blood out of her body, but she never moved once for fear the weasel would harm her chicks. And the pastor responded by saying to the farmer, and that's just like Christ. He endured all the suffering on the cross. He could have saved his life, but he would not, because if he had moved, we would all be lost. Jesus chose to die for you, to die for me. Let me ask you this question. Would you choose to receive him and to follow him with your whole life? That's what I've decided. I've decided I'm going to follow him till my dying day. The final part of that song, I'm going to play it for you, and the guys are going to play it right now. There, it's a teardrop from the face of God falling down. This comes from the movie The Passion of the Christ, Mel Gibson's movie, Passion of the Christ, and that teardrop comes, and that's how the movie The Passion of the Christ concludes this particular portion. All for you and me.